Is the slide visible?
Yes, sir.
So today we'll start with speed control of DC motors. Okay. So in this case, whenever we see the motor, motor is a device that gives out mechanical output. And the output what I am getting from the motor for doing any useful work is in the form of speed and torque. So when I want to control my output, when I want a controlled output, the quantities that I can control at the output are either speed or torque. Generally, when I control the speed, automatically many a times torque will get controlled. So exclusively, I need not to go for torque control all the time. Just by controlling or executing certain speed control techniques, my output torque is controlled. So speed control study of any motor, in this case, not only DC motor, it can be an induction motor or a synchronous motor. Synchronous motor is a constant speed motor. It doesn't come much with control mechanisms. For induction motor and DC motor, it becomes very important to study the speed control schemes, okay, so that I will get the controlled output. Now the question is, controlled output in the sense, not only the variation in the speed values, my output should be as good as the required output by the load. Yeah, I can control the speed by varying it from zero to rated value. Suppose I have a motor of 1500 RPM rated value, which we have in our labs. I can control the speed from zero RPM to 1500 RPM. There are ways to do that, but in doing so, what will be the output power? So the output power requirement by the load should not suffer. In the scheme of control, we should look into the matter that the output power required by the load should not suffer. So the required amount of output power should be supplied to the load so that the useful work is to be done. Along with this, I should be having a range of speed control so that I will get a controlled output. Okay. So speed control doesn't mean only variation of output speed or variation of the shaft speed. No doubt it is the variation of shaft speed, but still the output should be kept in the mind. Okay. The output should be sufficient to the load requirement. Okay. So we have many speed control mechanisms for DC motor. We'll continue looking into that. Okay. So we'll see speed control of DC motor. So whenever we are looking into the speed control, we should be starting from the equations that will govern the speed. Okay. So whatever the analysis we do, all analysis is mathematical. Okay. So the equation in which the speed comes is the back EMF and the torque equation. But let us look into only the back EMF. Okay. So the back EMF equation is EB is equals to pi Zn by 60 into P by A. So this is the EMF induced in armature when the motor starts operating. Okay. Or I can write speed as, because I want speed control, I will write the equation in terms of speed. So speed is equals to, I will write it as EB 60A divided by pi Zp. So this is the speed, and for any given motor, when operating at a constant voltage, generally we operate the motors at constant voltages, input voltages. But once the machine is constructed, for any motor, okay, my Z, P, A are constants. 60 is already a constant. Therefore, my speed is proportional to back EMF and inversely proportional to the flux. This already we have seen. Speed is proportional to back EMF and inversely proportional to the field flux. But EB is equals to, from the voltage equation, we have V minus IRA. V minus IRA, this is for a shunt motor. And it is equals to V minus IA into RA plus RAC. This is for series and compound motor. Let us take instantly series motor. Okay. Let me take a general value of resistance R. Okay. Let R is equals to RA for shunt motor, and R is equals to RA plus RAC for series motor. So I can write the voltage equation EB is equals to as V minus I into R. Okay. Let me write it as V minus I into R, so armature current I into R generally. Therefore, speed I can write it as N is proportional to V minus I into R divided by phi. Okay. So this is the speed governing equation for DC motor. This equation you should remember always. Any method we choose, it is based on this equation only. So this is the speed governing equation for a DC motor. Okay. Now on the RHS of this equation, we see there are three quantities. One is applied voltage, resistance drop, and the flux. So it is clear from the RHS of the equation that the speed is now depending upon three quantities. Okay. This speed is not depending upon three quantities. It is depending upon the applied voltage V. It is depending upon the resistive drop. It is depending upon the flux. Okay. So I can control the speed of a DC motor by controlling these three quantities or by varying these three quantities. So there are three ways of controlling the speed of DC motor. Okay. One, by controlling or by varying the applied voltage V. One, by varying the flux phi. Other, by varying the resistive drop. Okay. In the armature series circuit. Okay. So from above equation, we can say that the speed depends on applied voltage, armature resistance drop, and the flux. Okay. Therefore, speed of DC motor can be varied speed of DC motor can be varied varied or controlled, both are same, by following ways, by following mechanisms, or by following methods. First, by varying flux. By varying flux phi. Okay, so this method is known as flux control method or field control method. Flux control method or field control method. Second, so n is proportional to v minus ia into r. So r is the combined armature resistance in the armature circuit. Okay, by varying the armature resistance in the armature circuit, how I can vary is by including the external rheostatic resistance in the circuit. Okay, so I can vary the armature resistance, or I can't vary armature resistance, I can vary the resistance in armature circuit. Okay, that method is known as armature control method. By varying resistance in armature circuit. Now please note, it is not by varying the armature resistance. I can't vary armature resistance once the armature winding is fabricated. By varying resistance in armature circuit. Okay. So this method is known as armature control method. The third one is speed is proportional to V, that is applied voltage. Okay. So I can vary the speed even by varying applied voltage. By varying applied voltage. Now you can ask how I can vary applied voltage. Okay, because applied voltage is a constant source. Okay, we'll study, there is one mechanism, we'll study by varying applied voltage. So this method is known as voltage control method. This method is known as voltage control method. So there are three ways to control the speed of a DC motor. Okay. One by varying the flux, one by varying the resistance in armature circuit, and other third by varying the applied voltage. So we study all these three mechanisms for the speed control of DC motor. In that, first we look into is the flux control method. Okay. So first method what we see is flux control method. So first I will write the equation, the governing equation, n proportional to v minus Ia into R divided by phi. So it will be easy for us to refer. DC shunt motor. Exclusively now we are studying the speed control of DC shunt motor. Okay. Here, speed control of DC motor. Now we will study exclusively shunt motor. A shunt motor can be drawn. So in the field control of DC shunt motor, what we do is we add a external rheostat in series with the feed winding. We add an external rheostat in series with the feed winding. Because I have to control the flux, to control the flux, I have to control the field current. So this is RHF, the field rheostat, and this is the current ISH. Current I and the current IA. So here in flux control method, what we do is, first thing what we do here is, here we add a rheostat in series with field winding. So this is field rheostat RHF. This method we many times used in our practicals in previous semester. Okay, when you are conducting generator experiments, you controlled the speed, you adjusted the speed to rated value by varying the field rheostat of motor. So that there you did the flux control method of speed control. Okay, there we varied the rheostat connected in the field of motor, right? So this is the same rheostat that we are talking about now. Okay, so here from the governing equation, I can say that for flux control method, we add a rheostat in series with the field winding first, second, applied voltage is constant. Applied voltage is constant and resistance in armature circuit is constant. Resistance in armature circuit is constant. Okay, so therefore my V minus IARI will remain constant. Hence, my speed is inversely proportional to flux. For flux control method, my speed is inversely proportional to flux. And my flux is directly proportional to ISH, the shunt current. Therefore, my speed is inversely proportional to ISH. So if I vary the flux, if I vary the field current, speed is varied. Okay, this we know. So here what we do is, we add an external resistance in series with the field winding. The minimum possible value of external resistance is zero. I can't reduce the external rheostatic value below zero. It is, the minimum value is zero. Okay, it is as good as not connected in the series. So that position of the rheostat is known as cutout position of the rheostat. Okay, this we have seen in the procedures. Okay, so when the rheostat is in cutout position or at zero resistance position, what will happen is, the current drawn by the shunt field coil is the rated current. Okay, whatever the designed value of ISH I have is drawn by the field current because RHF is zero. So with the rated current drawn by the field coils, the rated flux is produced. When the rated flux is produced, the rated speed is obtained. This is theoretically. Okay. So when I don't include any rheostatic resistance in series with the field, initially, the speed value what I obtain is the rated value or near to the rated value. Okay, near to the rated value. Now I want to control the speed. I want to vary the speed. The only possible of variation of the rheostat is to increase the value of resistance. I can't decrease below zero. Now I can increase it. Now when I increase the rheostatic value, resistance value RHF, my ISH goes on decreasing. Okay, my field current goes on decreasing because this rheostat is in series with the field. When I increase the series resistance, current in that branch decreases. Therefore, ISH decreases. As ISH decreases, flux decreases. Therefore, speed increases. Okay. So by adding the resistance in the field circuit of DC motor, my speed of the DC motor increases. Okay. But when I had kept the rheostatic value zero initially, the speed was rated value. Now when I have decreased the field current or by increasing the resistance, the speed is going beyond the rated value. Okay, the minimum speed available with the flux control method is rated speed. If I want to vary the speed using flux control method, it will be varied only above the rated speed, above the normal speed or a base speed. Therefore, this method of controlling the speed is known as above the rated speed method. So using flux control method, I can control the speed of DC motor above the rated value. I can't control below the rated value, because if I have to control below the rated speed, then I should be having a mechanism for controlling it below the rated value. But the minimum speed obtained at zero position of the field rheostat is rated speed. Therefore, flux control method gives us the speed control of DC motor above the rated speed. Okay, so we look into this once again. Observe, as the speed is inversely proportional to flux and inversely proportional to ISH, as initially my RHF is zero. Initially, when RHF is zero, then rated ISH flows, giving rated speed of the motor. Giving rated speed of the motor. Okay, when the field rheostat is varied, increased, ISH decreases, because ISH is equals to what? Okay, you can write here ISH is equals to V divided by RSH plus RHF. Okay, so when RHF increases, ISH decreases, therefore flux decreases and speed increases. Now this speed, which was initially the rated value, is now increasing beyond the rated value. Okay, therefore speed increases, beyond the rated value. Therefore, speed increases beyond the rated value. Okay. So, with this method of speed control, I can control the speed only above the rated speed. Okay. So, with flux control, with flux control method, speed of DC motor, DC shunt motor, speed of DC shunt motor can be controlled above the rated speed. Can be controlled above the rated speed. Now, how will be the variation? Okay. Now I have seen I can control above the rated speed, but how will be the variation? Will it vary very largely, or will it vary almost constant? In what way? We can see. Okay. And up to what value I can control? Is it that always I can go on increasing the value of field resistance so that my flux decreases, speed increases? I can't do that. There is a limit. Okay, so I can increase, theoretically I can increase the speed up to 3:1 ratio. It means at the max 3 times the rated speed. Not beyond that. If the machine is of 1000 rpm rated value, I can increase up to 3000 rpm theoretically. Practically, it may not be possible. Practically, I can't go even almost the double the value. Okay, because there are many complications practically that we get because of large centrifugal forces. There can be a mechanical damage to the rotor, and commutation problems will occur. Okay, so up to 3:1, I can increase. Theoretically, but practically not. Okay. Now, what happens when I do this? I should observe that also. No doubt, just by adding a rheostat in the field, by varying it, I can control the speed. This is a mechanism. But what are the consequences? The consequence is that if the field rheostat is increased largely, if I keep large value of RHF, then ISH will be of very smaller and smaller values. Already ISH is very small. Okay, the value of field current what I get practically in a shunt motor is around 0.4, 0.5 amperes, which is already a very small value. When I'm adding resistance in series with the field current further decreases. Now with the decrease in field current, what will happen? Field weakening starts happening. Field weakening in the sense, now to operate a motor, I need a magnetic field. Is it? A current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field experiences the force. Now, this is the field which is giving us the magnetic field. Now, when I'm increasing the field resistance, field current is decreasing, the magnetic field required for motor operation starts decreasing. Therefore, the force produced, F equal to BIL, the force produced starts decreasing. So the motor action starts suffering. The prime requirement of the motor is to operate it as a motor. But when in a method of controlling it, I should not go to an extent where the motor action itself starts getting suffered. So that point we call it as field weakening point. So I should not increase the field rheostat or decrease the shunt current beyond field weakening point. So if field weakening starts happening, one, the speed is very large, that is from this equation we will see. Second is motor operation suffers because commutation problem starts occurring. So this is one danger. Okay, we can say this is one danger or some harm we can say can occur if the control of the field rheostat is not done properly. Okay. Other than this, it is one of the most easiest way to control the speed of a DC motor. Okay. It is very economic because field current is very less. If I add more resistance, the field current further decreases. Therefore, copper losses will not matter. So with a very minimum amount of losses, very minimum amount of losses, I can get a large range of speed control, but that too above the rated speed, not below the rated speed. I can't control the speed of motor using flux control below the rated value, because in flux control method, the minimum speed what I get is rated speed. Okay, so I have to control it above the rated value. So the advantages of this method is, But even when we observe the curve, okay, if I draw the speed versus armature current curve, okay, it will almost remain constant. Okay, so like I told, the output should not suffer. Okay. Let this be the rated speed. Okay. So if this is the speed curve without RF, when I include the shunt field rheostat, the speed will increase. So this is with RF. Okay. As I increase the resistance, speed increases. Because flux decreases, speed increases. Okay. So the advantage of this method is, it is very economical. Okay. So it is very easy and convenient. Easy and convenient method. Second is, it is economic. Okay. Economic in the sense of losses. Okay. I need not to invest more on power just for the control. Okay. Economic method. As lower ISH cause low losses. Actually, the losses in shunt field are generally neglected. Shunt field copper loss are generally neglected because they are very small. Further, it is lowered. Okay. Okay. And one more bigger advantage is that, independent of load condition, I can control the speed. Okay. Speed control is independent of load. Because the mechanism operation, in this mechanism, the operation is done in field, which is independent of load circuit. Okay, speed control is independent of load. So these are the advantages. Disadvantages. Okay, the first main disadvantage is, I can control the speed only above the rated value. Speeds only above rated value can be controlled. Rated value can be controlled. Second is, I can't increase the speed randomly. It means I can't just go on increasing the rheostatic value so that speed increases. There is a maximum limit for the increase in speed. Okay. Speed beyond rated value cannot be increased up to maximum limit. Cannot be varied after maximum limit. After maximum limit. Okay. Because with this, field weakening and commutation problems occur. Okay. As field weakening and commutation problems occur. Commutation is one process in the DC machine which will impose limitation on everything. Commutation problem occurs. It is because of commutator, the DC motor and DC generator are not famously used or widely used in the general applications. Okay. So these are the main disadvantages. One more is that I can't decrease the RHF below zero. That is, I can't control the speed below rated value. That is one disadvantage. Okay. So this is all about the flux control method of a DC shunt motor. So what we have seen in the flux control method is, I add a series rheostat in series with the field current, sorry, field winding. So by addition of field rheostat, the initial value of the field rheostat is zero. When initial value of field rheostat is zero, I obtain the rated speed. Once I start increasing the field rheostat, the shunt current decreases, flux decreases, therefore speed increases, and the speed increases only beyond the rated speed. Okay, so flux control method gives a speed control above the rated value. Okay, so this is the gist of flux control method. Okay. Next is armature control method. Armature control method. So in flux control method, I added a rheostat in field circuit. Okay. In armature control method, I will add a rheostat in armature circuit. That's it. Okay. So here, what we do is a control rheostat, a control resistance, or a rheostat you can call. A control resistance is added in series with armature. In series with armature. Okay. So let me call it as RC, a control resistance. Now there is nothing added in the field circuit. The field circuit is free. Okay. A full voltage is applied across the field circuit. Therefore, a full field current will flow and a rated flux is produced. Is IA. Okay. Now I have a resistance RA inherently in the armature winding. So here again a governing equation for the speed, N proportional to V minus I into R, IA into R divided by phi. So in this case, my V is constant applied voltage, okay. So phi is proportional to ISH and ISH is equals to V by RSH, which is also a constant. Okay, so therefore flux is constant. Okay, so the flux is constant. Now here, therefore, n is now proportional to v minus ia into r. So here r is what? It is armature resistance plus control resistance in series with armature. So n is now proportional to v minus ia into r plus r, ra plus rc. V minus I into RA plus RC. Now, when the control resistance is at its zero position, okay, because the minimum value of any resistance is zero, it is a variable resistance, so I can vary it from zero to its value, its rated value. Okay. So when control resistance is zero, when control resistance is zero, n is proportional to v minus ira. This is back emf. V minus ira or v minus ia into ra plus rc is a back emf. N is proportional to v minus ira. So what does it mean? At a particular load condition, speed is of some value. Now, if I consider the rated load, the speed is at rated value. Okay. So when the control resistance is zero, a rated current in the armature flows, giving the rated speed of the motor. So whether it is a flux control method or an armature control method, when the controlling rheostats are at zero position, I get a rated speed. Now, what happens once I vary the control rheostats is the study. Okay. So here, when the control resistance RC is kept zero initially, a rated armature current flows if there is a load. If there is no load, no load current flows. A rated at that particular let us consider it as no load only. A rated no load armature current flows, rated speed of the motor is obtained. So when the control resistance is not added, the speed of the motor is rated value, whether flux control or armature control. Now when I increase the control resistance, okay, as RC is increased, what happens? V minus IA into RA plus RC decreases. Therefore, speed decreases. Okay. As RC increases, V minus IA RA plus RC decreases. Therefore, speed decreases. Now, initially when the control resistance is zero, speed was rated value. When the control resistance starts operating, when I increase the control resistance, the speed is below the rated value. So here in armature control method, I can control the speed of DC motor below the rated speed. Flux control method will give the above the rated speed control. Armature control method gives below the rated speed control. Okay, so I can't have the speed control with armature control method above the rated value, because the maximum speed what I can obtain in armature control method is the rated speed when the control resistance is zero. So when control resistance is increased, my back EMF in the armature decreases, therefore speed decreases. So here with armature control method, I can control the speed of motor below the rated value. Okay. When RC is equals to zero, n is proportional to V minus IRA, it is the rated speed. It's the rated speed. As RC increases, V minus IRA plus RC decreases, therefore speed decreases. Okay. That is below rated speed. Okay. So therefore, using armature control method. Using armature control method, speed of DC shunt motor can be controlled below the rated value. Below the rated speed. Below the rated speed. Okay. So when you see the curve, if you can observe. If you see the speed versus armature current curve, it is almost remaining constant. This is without RC. Okay, this is rated. This is rated speed. Okay, so when I use RC, okay, the speed will decrease below the rated value. Okay, so this is the variation of speed with respect to load or with respect to the control resistance. Okay, now these two mechanisms, the advantage is nothing much, because the problem with this method is I am adding rheostat in series with armature, and armature current is very large. It depends upon the load. Okay, so this is actually a disadvantageous method as it incurs large amount of copper losses in armature. Okay, as it incurs large amount of copper losses in armature. So disadvantage is that okay. Large power loss occurs in control resistance. RC, because it carries armature current. As complete armature current flows through RC, large copper losses occur. Okay? Therefore, efficiency decreases. Okay? Efficiency decreases, and the speed regulation is very poor. Okay, we have a poor speed regulation. Okay, what is speed regulation? Like we have voltage regulation. Speed regulation is nothing but my speed at no load minus speed at full load divided by speed at full load. For transformers and generators, we calculate voltage regulation because output of these two machines is electrical. For motors, we calculate speed regulation because output of these machines is mechanical. Okay, so my change in speed from no load to full load should be minimum generally. I don't expect it to be maximum. Okay, so the speed regulation is poor if I use this method of speed control, because there is a large variation of speed below the rated value. Okay, why large variation occurs? Because this IA is large. Okay, this IA is large. Okay, now for giving a small instance, I can say, now let V be 200, okay. IA be say 10 amperes, RA be say 1 ohms for instant. So let us take RC 0 initially, then what will be my speed? Speed is now proportional to 200 minus 10 into 1. So it is proportional to 190. Okay. Now if RC is say increased, okay, it is increased say by few ohms. So let us take only 5 ohms. Okay. And then my speed will be proportional to 200 minus 10 into 1 plus 5. So it is proportional to 6. Okay, it is 140. Okay. So as I increase the resistance, the speed is largely varying. Therefore, speed regulation is poor. Okay, the speed regulation is poor. So with this disadvantage, the armature control method suffers actually. So when we use armature control method, we should keep it in mind that it will come with a large power loss. It will come with a large power loss. Okay. So it depends upon the type of application that I'm using for controlling the speed of DC motor. Okay, so what application I have for the motor operation decides what kind of speed control mechanism I should be choosing. Okay, so these are the two methods of speed control. The third method, voltage control method, we'll look in the next session. Okay, so any doubts so far? So what we are doing in armature control method? In armature control method, I am adding a rheostat, a control resistance in series with the armature. Okay. So when I vary this control resistance, the voltage available across armature varies. The voltage available across armature is back EMF. Okay. The voltage available across armature is nothing but here it is back EMF, EB. Okay. So by varying the field armature control resistance, I am varying the voltage available across the armature. That is, I am varying the back EMF. So by varying back EMF, I am getting variation in the speed. Okay. So initially, when the control resistance is kept zero, I get a rated back EMF induced in the armature. Therefore, the speed of the motor is at rated value or near to the rated value. Okay. But when I increase the control resistance value, the voltage available across armature decreases. That is, back EMF decreases. Therefore, speed falls down, speed decreases. So initially, when the control resistance is not effective, the speed is rated. When the control resistance is added, the speed is below the rated value. So with the armature control mechanism or with armature control method, I can control the speed of DC motor, DC shunt motor, below the rated speed. With flux control, I can control above the rated speed. With armature control, I will control below the rated speed. Okay, so because the speed variation is large below the rated value, it suffers with poor speed regulation problem. Okay, so this is all about flux control and armature control method of speed control for a DC shunt motor. Okay, so any doubts so far? Yes, any doubts?
No, sir.
So in the